Hello, everybody, and welcome to Ollie's Tubes. At this time, I would like to do something very different for me and also, I think, for the viewers here. So first of all, as you already might have recognized, I am speaking in English now to do some content for my English-speaking viewers. Secondly, I put my face into the camera that you can see everybody who is talking to you. So, and on top of that, if you don't like the English, you can turn on the German subtitles. Quite funny, right? And now with that, you can choose whether to have the Google translated subtitles, which may include some fun already, or you can choose not to turn on subtitles and to listen to my bad English. So, it's your choice what you would like to do. So now, the first thing what I would like to do is, I would like to give a tour through my, I would call it workshop, because there was somebody requested this and I thought, why not? That's a good idea. So I will try to do that as best I can. Hope you enjoy it and let's get into it. I'm standing here in front of the door, and I think that's a good starting point to have a look what is inside here. So here you can find, first of all, a lot of dust, because I have just this room, so which means if you do any woodworking and things like that, you will create some dust, and yeah, this is what you find everywhere. So if you have more space than I have, it may be a good idea to have a dedicated room for this dust creating things, what you may need to do. So what is inside this? Well, this and that, I would like to say. So first of all, there is lots of connectors, adapters, things and that, what you may find you don't need it directly, but lots of the time you need it later, and therefore you keep it. So this is what is inside here. So next is some mechanical stuff. This is also, let's say, a good idea to have something like this. For example, nuts, screws, or different sizes of screws. Screws wooden for wood. Metric nuts, some nails. Another point what you need from time to time is springs. So if you dismantle any gear, just take the springs and put it aside. Later you will need it. Another screws, different things. And another different, I don't know the English word for this. You may see it here. It's not what you need immediately, but from time to time you need something special and then you have it. So what's next here? So lots of resistors here. Different values of resistors, different sizes. So everything what you need to repair this old stuff, what I'm dealing with. So, and this is the same here. So lots of resistors, capacitors, old stuff and newer stuff. So all the parts more or less sorted for easy access. So if you look here, this old locker is from about 1960s. Originally that was an old kitchen, and a friend of us, the grandma, she died, and this one They were about to throw it away, and I say, no, don't do that. I will keep it for myself, and I will use it for my workshop. Because that material is, let's say, well, you can't break it so easy. This is what I like about it. So the only thing, at one time we have moved in a flat where the basement was quite small and I had to cut the plate here. But doesn't matter, it works like it is now. So next thing is, this is my DC power supply. This is what I have built by myself, except the cabinet. I don't know where this came from. During my apprenticeship, I built this one, and the cabinet was about to be thrown away as well. So I just went to my boss at that time and asked him, hey, can I have it? And he gave it to me. So I built this DC power supply by myself at that time, and I'm still using it. It's working fine from that time. Until about last year, when I tried to put 300 volts inside here, and of course the IC inside didn't like it so much, so it blew up and I had to repair it. So next to it, this is some kind of isolation tester. You can have different voltages from 0 to 2000 volts. And with that, you are able to check capacitors for leakage. So I don't have a capacitor tester which puts out different voltages. I always use this one, and it's working fine as well. So it's like I never did something to it, and it's working since long time for me. If you look here, so this is a Heathkit. Many people knows Heathkit, I think. IG82, which is, let's say, a generator for sine and square waves, and within the frequency range from, I think, about 20 hertz to about 2 megahertz. Yeah, you can use it for many things. Also, you can use it as a test generator for radios. That is quite possible. I did it before I had the actual test generator. So this one below that, this is a stereo cooler. If you may see, it's quite a lot of dust here, which means I didn't use it until now, because I don't have stereo radios to repair. So I got it one time from the workshop, which was closed. There was a shop which was dealing with radios and televisions, and they also repaired those stuff. And after closing this shop, they just gave it to me because nobody uses it anymore. And I will keep it. So what's next here is my oscilloscope. This is fully equipped with tubes, so there's no semiconductor here. And this is from Philips, from the, let's say, I think 58, something like that, 1958. I just changed all the caps because they were very, very leaky. And at the first time I tested this, and it started to smoke somewhere, and I checked all of them, and for everyday use, that was not suitable, so I changed them. But from that time, this is now some years ago, it's still working fine without any problem. I don't use it very often, but sometimes you need it. So here, what's next? I call this the clickety-clucky multimeter, because this is an auto-range multimeter, and there's some relay logic inside. You will hear it. So there are some relays clicking. This is why I call this the clickety-clucky multimeter. It's also working very fine. At one time, the death cap, some people call it death cap, the across the line capacitor just failed and blew up, but that was all. So I just removed it and it's working since then. So this one, oh, this is a little bit complicated to get into the shop, to the shot. So this is what some people, they called the cheese triangle. And reason for this is, as you may see, if you go a little bit far away, the shape of this case is like that you can put it directly in the edge of your bench, which saves, well, I think it saves some space. And what is inside here? Primary, this is an isolation transformer. And secondly, this is a variac as well. And also, what is also very important, 3 meters, voltmeter, which is here, which shows what the voltage is, what you have adjusted with the variac. Current draw, you can see here, and also the power consumption, you can see here, which is also something, an interesting number, if you turn on new radio or something, then you may see if something starts to short. When this needle is climbing up, you know something is going on. So that's very helpful. So below that, it's the test speaker. And as this is also from the 1960s, there is an output transformer inside with different tapping points. And as you see, there's this electro switch. You can choose different impedances from this output transformers. You have 5 ohm, which is then straight to the speaker. You have 800 ohms, 3K, 5K, and 7K. So you can cover almost all output tubes with this one for testing purposes. So, and then you have some circuit breakers here. So that's all what is inside here. Oh no, it's not all. So there's something on the side here, but this I don't use it. So this is a DC power supply. Somebody made it by himself. I think 0 to 30 volts or things like that, but very simple circuit. No short circuit protection, no nothing. So I just keep it like that. I don't use it. So as you're getting older, I would say the end of the 40s, you may need this one. This is the lens with, let's say, some illumination below that. Sometimes very helpful if you have to deal with small stuff and you want to point the light directly to the small stuff to work on it. That's okay. Besides this, this lamp is also a very good noise generator. You can put it on top of the radio or amplifier and you will hear some noise, because this is LED technology and you can, let's say, you can choose the intensity like this, and this is what you will hear in the AM bands a lot. So from that point of view, that's not very good. So the next, what we have here, some gear what you need more often. Primarily, this is of course the soldering iron. This one, it's from Bella, as you can see. I have this now quite some time. The old one what I had before, I got it about, I think 25 years I kept it, and it starts to fail. There was some intermittence somewhere and I couldn't find it, so I purchased a new one, which was also the analog version with, I think, the same circuitry as the old one, and this is holding up quite nicely. So this one is, how to call it in English, solder sucker, something like that. You can suck melted solder inside this. Soldering iron, this is a special one, and this is very helpful if you want to remove components from circuit boards in order not to destroy the circuit board. Very helpful thing. And yeah, also this one is quite old. I think it's now around 30 years old. And originally that was for also for a workshop, I think. And therefore, I think this will hold up very good. So cross fingers, it's still working. So here I have, that is a hot air soldering station. My son bought it to do some surface mount stuff. So I don't like that stuff because it's too small, but he is using it from time to time. And I will use it as well if I need some hot air for shrink tube, for example. So next thing here on the bottom line, because this is very heavy stuff, this is the regulated power supply for, I think it put out 300 volts and maybe 60 milliamps, something like that. So there's some tube regulation going on inside. So this is all tube stuff. So it's very heavy. It's working okay, but if you keep it on too long, the voltage is running away. So I think there's some capacitors what needs to be changed or things like that. But until now, I didn't take the time to do something about it. So what we have here, you really want to look at this? Okay, if you like it, it's up to you. So what is next? This is from also from the mid and 50s, 1950s, which is the a bridge. You can use it for capacitors and for resistors to measure them. On top of that, it's also a possibility to use it as a leakage tester for capacitors. So it puts out around 250 volts. And with this one, you can check it by watch what the eye tube is doing. Let me turn it on. You can see it, what happened here. So the eye tube is not the original one. The original one was the magic eye and not this one. But it was, let's say, I don't want to burn it out for nothing. So this one is quite often in use. And as you can see, the magic, this magic stripe, or how you want to call it, it's working okay. So it looks like this, and you can find the minimum like that. This is how this works. So at the moment, this is in calibration here. This is why I can find the minimum without connecting anything to it. So you have it's like that, and the pointer should be at straight up. And this means everything is fine. Sake of testing, I took out this capacitor, which is 1000 picofarad, and I will connect it here, and then we can see how this looks like. Now I try to do this one-handed, and I may fail with this. Yeah, one moment, please. So now I connected the capacitor here, and I just need to find a lot of reflections here going on. So maybe like that. So now I try to find the minimum on the magic eye, like this. And now you can read the pointer, which says 0.1, 0.11. So times 1000 times 10, so which equals 1000 picofarad. So now you know the capacity of this. And another point, what you will see here, you have quite a good eye opening, so which means the isolation, there's not too much leakage here with this capacitor. It's working, it's okay. If you compare it with this one, which is, I think, quite old paper capacitor, which I think it's very leaky, it's 10 nanofarad. So if you see what happens here with the Magic Eye, you barely see an eye opening. And also, there's not really any, let's say, sharp eye opening. You have lots of room from here to there where you can see the eye open and close. So which means this one is quite leaky. So then I can put it to the isolation tester. Shall I do it? Okay. So I just connected it here, and this ERO is rated 250 volts. So let's see what happened. So first of all, you have to adjust the needle to infinity, and now you can ramp up the voltage. So this is 50 volts. This is 250 volts. And you see it's already some leakage going on here. If I disconnect it, it's go back to infinity. So this scale here is only valid for 50 volts. So which means in the 50 volt range, you can use it also to measure resistance. So this is the purpose of that one. So this is not really an accurate measurement. This is just a tester. So which means you can see if it's more or less leakage. That's all. So this is quite bad. It's just 250 volt cap. So enough of that. So the next one is also from Philips, from 1950s, I think 55 to 58, somewhere like that. This is all the same series. So this is what I was looking for. I just try to collect something together which fits somehow. And this Philips stuff was all over the place, and you can find it very often. And this gear is, I say, very reliable, I think. So if you check out this one, so you can measure ohms here. Ohms will be measured with 100 volts, so which means you can use it as well to check capacitors for leakage in the range of 100 volts. Sometimes this is also very helpful. What you should not do is use it to check semiconductors like this. I think they partly don't like this 100 volts, so be careful in that point. So what else can we do here? Of course, we can measure the milliamps here, but there is no tube involved here, so this is normal analog current meter. And then you have, what is that? Here is the input for voltage measurement. This one can take up to 1 kilovolts on these terminals. On top of that, there is a probe for AC, which is digged in somewhere behind it. But this one I built it by myself because that was missing when I got it. I got this one from the swap meet for very cheap, and it just was working, and I use it from that time. One time I have calibrated it, but I did nothing more to that. It's working fine. This one is quite interesting as well. This is the signal tracer, what you can use to, let's say, for fault finding in radio receivers. You can use the signal tracer. Also here, different probes like this one. This is a straight probe which is connected to the amplifier inside here. Oh, I have no socket free available. Okay, I just can take out one. I plug it in and then you can see what happened. Just wait a second. When the magic eye turns on. Okay, now it's coming. It's coming. And now you can hear, if you touch this one, you can hear the hum. So this is what it's doing. So if you have some problems in circuits, audio circuits, you can use this one to find the area where the signal is missing. So very useful device. Even for this one, there is another probe available, a diode probe, which you can use to probe RF circuits to repair radio receivers. Also very useful. So next thing, oh, this one, it came with this cheese wedge together. I never used it, but it matches because it's also from Philips. You can tell by the knobs here. And yeah, this is just a power supply, 9-volt power supply. I think this was used to repair transistor radios in the beginning. You need some power supply for this one, which was not 300 volts. So here, that is my sweep generator. You may find it in another video where I have used it to align the IF in the, I think it was one of these, I think it was a Zaba and the FM IF, 10.7 megahertz. I used this one together with the oscilloscope to show the shape of the, well, let's say how to call it, the curve which comes out of the IF amplifier. Also for this one, you have several frequencies. As you can see, you can use it for televisions as well. If you want to align television IF strips, it is possible with this one. The next thing is another vacuum voltmeter, which is possible to be used up to 1 megahertz and direct input at 300 volts. This is also very helpful for audio circuits. It came together with a bridge to, let's say, to check for distortions in audio circuits. But this one also, I never used it till now, so maybe I will put it in use from in a later time when I will repair this amplifier. Maybe that's a good chance to try this one out. So last but not least, this is the frequency counter, which is also very handy if you want to check calibration from this generator, for example. So, oh, one thing I have left here on my desk, which is this device. This has been, this, I think it is self-made from the same guy who gave this stereo coder to me. So, which means that was also part of the workshop where they repaired radios and televisions in the 90s. And yeah, this was built by himself. You can check amplifiers with this one. And I will turn it around and you can see what is inside. So it looks like this. Lots of chaos inside. So which means we have two FET resistors. I don't know how many watts they can take, but they can take a lot. So this is a load for the amplifier. And another point is there is some circuitry inside which generates a sine wave and which we can use to test amplifiers. Another circuit is inside which is testing for DC voltages on the terminals of the speaker. So this is what something what you don't want to have DC voltage on your speaker, because it can destroy your speaker. So this testing device is able to check these things. As I said, I use it one time, it's working okay, but if you look inside, that is a very sloppy work. So I think from a later time I will take it apart and I try to do it a little bit better. So I think I got everything now. This one, yeah, a separate video will come on this. This is my daily used amplifier, Luxman L190, which I need to service a little bit, because all the switches are very, very dirty. And also there is one transistor missing. And also I would like to check the capacitors, if they are still usable or not. But as I said, that's a point for another video. So that was it for this one. You see, N40s need the glasses. So where I left off, that was it for this one. I hope you like, I hope you enjoyed this tour through my small workshop. And if you do so, you can click the subscribe button here, or you can follow me on Odyssey. I would really appreciate this. And if you want to let me know something, just drop it in the comments. I will answer all of them, because as you see, the channel is very small at the moment. So I'm able to catch up all of your comments and I can give you an answer on this. So see you on the next one. Bye.